IVM.
When I visited Seoul for the first time, I was astounded. The night markets came alive around 1:30 a.m. The high-rise buildings towered over palaces. Public transport was so easy to figure out. Suffice it to say, I had a lovely time. Seoul is the political, economic, and cultural capital of South Korea. The population density of Seoul proper is twice that of New York and 8 times bigger than Rome. Seoul capital area is the second largest metropolitan in the world. It won't be an exaggeration to say that most people in South Korea live in and around Seoul. But what happens when there is indiscriminate growth? How does it affect society and the environment? And considering how quickly India is urbanizing, what lessons can we glean from Seoul's case? Hi, you're listening to States of Anarchy, a podcast on global affairs and foreign policy. I'm your host, Hamsini Hariharan. The history of South Korea is the history of Seoul. Last week, Eric Morbrand spoke to us about South Korean democracy and how it affected its economy. Now, we can talk about politics and economics, but a city is a living, breathing thing that you interact with every day. It's a reflection of all these concepts. My guest for today is Yang Sung-hee. She's the director of the Design and Research Unit at Yangji & Co. The company works on urban regeneration projects around Korea with a multidisciplinary approach that combines architecture, design, planning, research, and participation. As a Korean urbanist, Yang Sung-hee studied and worked in civil engineering, architecture, and urbanism in Seoul, Beijing, London, Zurich, and Mumbai. Yang Yang, as her friends call her, is also a close friend of my family, and her insights about Seoul and cities are always illuminating. But before we go into the episode, let's take a short break.
Hey everybody, welcome to another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Speaking of social media, one of the things that we really enjoy doing is we love seeing screenshots of people listening to our shows. So if you're listening to something and you want to let us know what you think about things, just take a screenshot, post it to Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, wherever, and tag us, and we'll tag you back and we'll talk to you and we'll let you know what we think or what you think. We'd also like to thank our sponsors for this month, Sawari, Storytel, and Paytm Money. We really appreciate the support. Also, on another note, an IVM-related note, we're looking to hire. We're looking for producers, content creators, audio engineers, back-end developers. We're looking for somebody in the data specialist kind of space, graphic designers. We're looking for all different kinds of people. So if you want to join one of the best places to work there is out there, then send us an email to careers@indusvox.com with your resume, and we'll get back to you shortly. On Cyrus says, actress and soon-to-be director Tiska Chopra talks to Cyrus about her childhood in Afghanistan, how she got pulled into acting, her new original web series Hostages, and how she's looking to write and direct more in the future. On the Rani Screwala podcast, Rani talks to me about the pursuit of inflection points, understanding the size of markets, and the importance of brand in creating scales. Speaking of the Rani Screwala podcast, if you want to send us some questions for Rani for his last episode, then please do so. It's at shows@indusvox.com. In case you missed it, check out episode 4 of The Note with Maruk and Nayan. She lists 5 reasons why Rahul Gandhi stepping down is the right decision. On Shunya One, Sheila Ditya and I are joined by Sachin Parekh, founder of Easy Roads. Easy Roads is a great platform that allows you to do local road trips, and we discuss the startup and the tech behind it and local travel. On the Empowering series, Zarina talks to Hetal Desai, senior VP at N Paradigm. They discuss different reasons why people quit their jobs, the importance of interpersonal relationships between employees and employers, and more. On the Pragati podcast, economist Anupam Manur is in conversation with Pawan about where Britain stands in regards to Brexit 3 years later and why it has cost them 2 prime ministers. And with that, let's continue on with your show.
Welcome back to States of Anarchy. I'm Hamsini Hariharan, and I'm in conversation with Yang Sung-hee about the city of Seoul and lessons it has for cities in developing countries. Hi, Yang Yang. Welcome to the show. Thank you so much for speaking with me. I'm so excited about this. I think this is like the most I've been excited about a podcast in Korea. Okay, so Seoul is one of the most developed cities in Asia. When I was traveling around the first week, I was just mind blown by everything that was here. And then I found out that, you know, 1/4 of South Korea's population lives in the city. How did Seoul develop to be such a huge urban center?
Yes. Hi, I'm Yang, and from Seoul. And I can say it happens because the government policy has been like this for last like so many years. Just after we have a Korean War, we used to be one of the poorest country in the world. And then government tried to set a strategy how we can develop our country in a faster way. Mm. And that the main policy was to focus on several cities. So they set Seoul as a capital city, and then they tried to focus on every infrastructure in Seoul. And then, so they built many schools, mm-hmm. and most of major university in Korea only exists in Seoul, a part of several few university. Then also many of the headquarters of the government, mm-hmm. and also the major companies are located in Seoul. So that's the, I think, main kind of like motivation why people move to Seoul from everywhere in the country. And then I have to say, yes, 1/4 of our population living in Seoul municipality, but the Seoul metropolitan, mm-hmm. including 29 satellite cities around Seoul, is more, even more. So 1/3 of the population actually rely on Seoul metropolitan area, I can say.
Oh, wow.
Yes. It's mad, I know.
Yeah, it is mad. And I'm thinking also, you know, after the war, when I was walking around places like Jongno, all those places were sort of bombed out after the war. There was very little there. So how did the government start building there? Like, now there are really tall buildings and like the really old parts of town, right? So, and I heard like a lot of houses got destroyed during the Korean War, even before that, during World War II. So how did Seoul deal with that?
Yes, there are majorly three different ways it happened. So one from the government. Yeah. So government set such a kind of like urban planning, yeah. to set a certain district to develop. Yeah. So they supply the main infrastructure such as a road, yeah. and like all the pipelines, yeah. At first, because they plan it. Okay, we want to develop this to supply a certain number of people. Yeah. So we have to construct all this. So mm. they did it. And then they did a collaboration with all different entrepreneurs. Mm. Many businessmen,
okay.
has a good relationship with our political part. Mm. And also we used to have several military dictators. Mm. And then they have always good relationship with the business part. Mm. So then they got a lot of incentive when they built many buildings and infrastructure in Seoul. Mm. A lot of taxation, mm. like a cut down of the taxation, and also some government budget also went there to mm. help them to build such a thingies. And also some illegal kind of thing also happened to make it happen much faster way. Mm. And then there are many also people from everywhere from the Korea. Mm. So they moved to Seoul and they settled down in Seoul. They start to make their own houses. Mm. And which now you can see in several places which has a really low-key level of the constructions, mm. and the low-key level of the building conditions. They are kind of the neighborhood which have built by the people's hand, like that. Yeah. So all combining all this together, mm. it can be bombed really fast. Mm-hmm. And then that time from 1960 till mm. 1990s, late 1990s, Korea has a really nice time for economic growth. Mm. So that the money income also can facilitate all the movements together. So with the development of the housings, mm. and the construction of the infrastructure, mm. and also the economic growth, mm. combining all together made Seoul this huge city, I have to say. Yeah.
Okay. And what do you think are the main challenges that Seoul City is facing now?
Yes. Because we developed too fast, I have to say. Mm. At this point of time, we can look back how we developed our countries, mm-hmm. and our cities. Mm-hmm. And then there are many parts are neglected, mm. because we only focus on certain kind of like buildings and certain housing complex and certain area to be certain goal. Mm. So many of other part of Seoul and countries are neglected, mm. To be cared. So there are many lack of infrastructure. Mm. Since government only focus on certain point of view, mm. so the others are left it. So they don't have that much infrastructure and the buildings are so bad condition. Mm. But now people's living condition is higher than before. So mm. they want to live in a, most of people want to live in a better condition than what they have. So mm. they are changing everything, but still the paces of it is much slower than before, since the economic condition is also not anymore going up like before. Since we had a two economic crisis in Korea, then the development paces is much slower than before. And then the government tried to deal with this neglected neighborhood right now with the so-called urban regeneration projects.
Okay.
But things are not as faster than before. So people feel a little bit difficult with it. Since Korean people always used to have the economic growth, and we are not growing anymore that fast.
So that must be very difficult as like a society, right?
Yes.
To go through so much economic growth and now unemployment is on a high, right?
Exactly.
And how? What is urban regeneration? I've been hearing like lots of good things about like Seoul's mayor who sort of like pioneered a lot of things, right? So what is urban regeneration?
Yes. Since we settled our government, the Republic of Korea, actually the right wing, we in Korea, we have two big political parties like other places, like one conservative party and the other is more like
more leftish.
But still, I think Korean left, like wing, is not super left wing, but still in middle left. And always the conservative party has haven't power so far. But from last like decade, the left wing started to have power. And then the new city mayor we have now, he's from actually from the left wing. And then he started to take care of this neglected neighborhood, so-called like village making. He started from the village making. So since although Seoul is a big country, each neighborhood has a kind of like big village kind of atmosphere.
Okay.
And then with this care of the village level, he believes, and many people believe, the life quality actually can get better. So rather than we always pursue the big goal, if we can deal with the daily life in a village level, the life quality can be better. From that idea, after like 10 years of his regime in Seoul, even the central government, we, I don't know you know about it, but we got some really dynamic of the changes in our political party in the central government. We impeached our former president.
Park
Geun-hye. Yeah, Park Geun-hye. And then we got a new president from the left wing. So this new president, Moon Jae-in, he's one of the main kind of policy is to make economic growth through the urban regeneration. Since that is his one of the main policy, so all many of the, a lot of government, central government's budget are going to the each different neighborhood to make it better. So that we called even New Deal urban regeneration.
That's very interesting. You know, you've lived in like a lot of countries, right? You've lived in Beijing, you've lived in Europe, you've seen India. How do you think Seoul's urbanization compares with like cities in India or cities like Beijing? It's a big question.
It is a big question. And also, my experience in Beijing was amazing also. Since that time, I was in Beijing from 2009 to 2012, something like that. That's the time just after the Beijing Olympic, the economic growth really fast. And the urbanization of the China, in overall China, was crazy. Now, Chinese government start to recognize the, some of the problem of the rapid like growth now. But back that time, was really rapid growth was happening. And then I can see all this development was super central government oriented. So since China still has a kind of like system that people cannot own their own land. All the land belong to government. And there are deal with the renting of the land for some years, sometimes like some can be short, can be long, but things like that. So things are really oriented by government policy. But here in Korea, yes, government policy is important, but the private sector's power is really strong here. Since for last decades, the economic growth already happened. And then there are many major developers and major companies actually take care of this physical development here. At the same time, the level of the people's like expectancy on their life is also went higher than before. So even single like families and single peoples wants to have a better quality of the buildings for their office and their like housings and for even the public places. So those dynamics are a bit different with China, I have to say. Although both country has been growing really fast, and also central government's role is very important. But still, Seoul's case is more dynamic. So if you come to Seoul, you will see there are many parts a bit messy and chaotic, but it allows also a lot of like dynamics and interesting things can happen inside of it. That's what I believe.
Yeah, even when you were talking about like the history of how Seoul developed, right? Yes, there are like the big chaebol firms. There's also like people who want to do. So you can see sort of like the three different prongs of action that's happening. Basically.
Yes, it's true. And the other thing I want to mention is actually when Korea developed so far, the foreign investors' like influence was actually not that important. Since Korea wasn't never that much interest for them first. Yes, it is, but not that much compared with China or some other developing countries.
Yeah.
So it was not like that before. So that's also, I think, is a big difference. Because in China, when I was there, I can see still the big foreign companies, like, influence was big. So they, like, kind of lead big changes, which never happened in China. So there was a big differences I have to mention also.
Yeah, I mean, I think at the end of the day, like, the businesses in Korea are, like, Korean-run. Right? Well, there are a lot of, like, Chinese-owned businesses now.
Yeah.
A lot of it was also manufacturing that was done for companies outside of China.
Exactly.
So that would have had, like, But are there, like, industries and things that are based in Seoul or are they based outside?
Before, in 1970s and 80s, yes, we used to have many factories also within Seoul. So there are several kind of like industrial complexes within Seoul. But from the 90s, government started to send these factories to outside of the Seoul, other cities, and also to China and also other countries, since the labor price went up also with by the time. So in Seoul, now we changed those industrial complex to other purpose. Since our also industry changes from the manufacturing to the more third like level of the more service-oriented like industry, so more IT and more technology-based like industry. So they don't need that much like spaces and infrastructure for continuing this industry. So in Seoul, most of these factories is turned to office business area. So if you go to Yeongdeungpo area or Seongsu area, these factories turn to, some of them turn to already office areas, some of them turn to a kind of like IT-based kind of area, some of them turn to a like cultural industry, like kind of base camp.
Wow.
It changes quite a lot, yeah.
And Seoul is, you know, like it's developed on par with many of the countries in the West, like countries in Europe, like places like America, right? So what lessons do you think it's gotten from the experiences of those countries?
Yes. There are many different ways it happened. First, since our country was a kind of victim of the Second World War, I have to say. Our country was the best rated from the Second World War and Korean War, post-Korean War. So when we started to develop back then, we thought, yes, we have to learn from developed country. So we send many scholars and many people to Western countries to learn how they developed. So we learn many of things from America and also Japan, because Japan was the country just next to us, so many people also went there to learn how they made the infrastructure. But majorly, even so far, major number of the professors in the university have studied in United States.
Okay.
And then they got their knowledge and skills and came back to Korea, and then they tried to apply it in Korean situations. So it means most of our regulations and also route to make the city also based on their regulation and their standard and their guideline.
Okay.
So that is the thing. And then we realize that, yes, Korea's context is different with America. America is such a huge country, and but Korea is a small, tiny country. It's so different. And then people start to see what is the problem, and then they try to also apply the European model. They start to see the European model. So how Europe developed their city, and they fix their city's problem with small, small things kind of is the way. So the trend actually has been changed. So I have to say the basic setup of the country is we follow the American regulation and methodology. And then now we are looking more European model to fix our city's problem.
At this point, let's take a break.
India's a massive subcontinent, home to truly stunning diversity. Behind the veils of smoke that obscure our thriving cities, our history is still alive, glimmering like sequins, waiting to be discovered. And if you, like me, are straining to hear the echoes of our past, this podcast is for you. I'm Anirudh Kanisetti, a history and geopolitics researcher, and I host Echoes of India, a history podcast about India, by Indians, and for Indians. In Echoes, we journey through the complex histories of South Asia and what they can teach us about our globalized world. Tune in every Wednesday on ivmpodcast.com or your favorite podcast app.
Welcome back after the break. You're listening to States of Anarchy, and I'm Hamsini Hariharan.
Why suddenly do you think is there a switch? Because I understand, you know, that adapting some other country's policies, because that's what we've been doing in India. And then we've been saying, but, you know, India is like a different country. It has a different context, like Korea. So a lot of the policies that work in developed countries won't just work here if you copy paste them. Right. So but there's been a switch in mindset that you said. Right. But like changing from sort of the American regulations to seeing what cities in Europe have been doing. Why the switch?
It is a complex, but from my point of view, I can say since we experienced those two big economic crises, one was in 1997 and one was 2008, we realized that the American model maybe not working in Korea. So with the failure of, after we observed the failure of the Lehman Brothers and this like big financial model in States. And then we start to look back what we have in Korea and how we deal these things. And then we see from Europe, there are more kind of like sustainable way of the development. Since Europe, from my point of view, again, maybe it's too personal point of view, but still I can say in Europe, people are more focused on what they have, some historical value. They give a lot of like value on it. And also they don't want to destroy their existing context. They respect what they have and then learn from them. And then they make a new thing out of it. And they are more cultural oriented and they try to look in more deeply. That's kind of a strong point of Europe, I believe. So I think Korea, after those two economic crises, when the real estate market doesn't work anymore like before, then people start to see what is the other methodology to make the values in within the city. So then people start to adopt European model. I think that's the thing. And also plus, many of people start to travel. Back then, we haven't traveled that much. But from 80s and 90s and now we travel a lot to other countries and people can experience what other countries has and people love what Europeans like cultures and their lifestyle. And then we realize that European like standard for many things like insurance or basic incomes or the labor kind of like healthcare. Yes. We try to like follow more like Northern Europeans like welfare system. So that also all things combined to make these transitions, I think.
Okay. And another interesting point that you brought up is culture, right? Because also Korea has like a distinctive culture that's also about hierarchy, that's also about family, that's not as individualistic as sort of the culture that's in North America. And I think urbanism is a big part of that because it's about how people interact with each other, right? Cities are where people have to sort of interact with each other.
Yes, it's a, again, broad question. But yes, it's true. Like Korea has been through many also transitions of the like social changes and also like cultural changes for last like 5-6 decades. That before Korean War, like even the early 60s and 70s, like Korea really family oriented country. So You are right. Confusion is our religion and our culture is a social norm in Korea still so far. Mm. So people have to respect older people, your teacher, and your even the random guy in your neighborhood. You have to respect. You have to show it. If not, you are not accepted in society. Mm. There's a kind of like strict rule we have in Korea. Nobody say to you, but it is. When we got a lot of influence from the Western cultures, especially from States, yeah, things changed a lot. Mm. People get more individualized. And also, with the thing which I mentioned in the beginning, many people move from their own hometown to Seoul. Mm. And then the family structure also has been changed. They used to live with the older extended family. Mm. But now they are nuclear family. Mm. Even at the moment, we have the one single family.
Yes,
a lot. And the structure of the family has been changed. And the shape of the housings also has been changed for adapting for this family structure. Mm. And people has been changed. But still, since my grandmother, who has been through this Japanese colonized time and Korean War, she's still alive. So still I have to have the kind of relationship with them. Mm. So still at the moment, our generation is a little bit confused with all these things. Mm. But I have to say, mixture of everything is a kind of like good point, kind of like big point of the Korea, which allowed we can have all the dynamics of making new cultures and also making a new contents. So people are like me, if you see in the city or even the rural area, everybody using smartphone. Mm. Even my grandma using smartphone. We are the country like that. Mm. So we experience so much changes. Mm. Yes, we always confused. We always lost. We are always stressed by it. But because of that, I think we can have the potentials to make more things. Mm. That's what I can see from my country.
No, I think that's a great point. Because like the idea is resilience, right? That like people have been through so much change. There's been wars, there's been governments that have been changing. There were dictatorships, then there was democracy.
Yes.
A lot of development. Cities are growing. So it's just like a constantly changing society. Like before this interview, when I asked you what your favorite thing about Seoul was, you said it was that it was dynamic. And yeah. I can see that's a reflection not only of the city, but like of the country itself.
Yes, right? I think so. Korean people, one of the strong points of the Korean people and Korean culture is the flexibility. Mm. Yes, we are not flexible on certain kind of things, but for most of other things, we are quite easy to adapt the changes. Mm. So maybe that's a reason why still Korean economy hasn't collapsed, or Korean culture things can be something in internationally. Mm. Like, yes, Korean people has a strong point on flexibility. They are quite good at adaptations, I have to say. Yeah. It was a difficult time. Yes, my mother always said, yes, when I was young like this, things are changing. But yes, that's the thing. But she complains, but still she adapts and she like act with these new changes. That's the big potentials of our country. Mm.
That's pretty awesome. So back to urbanization.
Yes.
What do you think, sort of, Seoul has so many lessons, right? We've spoken about like a lot of things that the country, the society has gone through. What lessons do you think will be applicable to developing countries like India? What can cities in India learn from Seoul's experience?
Yes, that's another serious topic. That yes, I heard that many of the developing countries try to follow some of the Korean developing models that since they see Korean like development model has been quite successful to make it happen really fast. So they even like import the Korean housing has been developed. Mm. I heard the Korean whole complexes are also adopted in other countries like that. Mm. Like it happens a lot in Vietnam also, and also India, and also other Southeast Asian countries. Mm. And some of the African countries also try to adopt this model. Even Honduras recently worked with a rent housing corporation in Korea. Okay. Things like that is happening. But I wish they can learn from the problems of Korea.
Okay.
More than the success of Korea.
Hmm.
Since we develop so fast, there are many problems we have. I told you in the beginning, there are many parts that are neglected.
Mm.
And then that makes everybody's lives a bit more difficult.
Mm.
Yes, our economy growth was fascinating,
mm.
but the actual life quality has been successful. No,
mm.
it wasn't. I believe as an urbanist, every day's life is more important than the GDP level of the country.
Mm.
If you are not happy, what does it mean the GDP level?
Mm.
So, and then if you are happy, then you can create more values inside of your life and your job. And then eventually, whole the growth gonna be more sustainable. That's what I believe.
Mm.
So I wish these developing countries can learn what is missing in Korean developing model. So then they don't have to repeat these problems and they should not repeat this problem. So I wish they can learn from the problems of the Korean developed model. And I wish they can really see the good and bad from the Korean developed model.
Hmm.
And most of people out there will be happier than Korean people. That's what I wish.
Yeah, I hope for that too. Across the world, what do you think are the biggest challenges to all cities today, not just Seoul? Like, climate change, for example, is the first thing that comes to my mind. But what do you think are the biggest challenges to cities today?
Most part of the Korea
mm-hmm.
is saying that our city is going to be disappear within some decades. That's what we are saying. Because we don't give a birth anymore.
Mm.
The birth rate in Korea is really low. It's one of the lowest in the world. And the suicide level rate is number one, almost number one in the world. I have to check what is the recent record.
No, but the suicide rate in Korea is very high.
It's very high. It means the population growth already has been stopped. And then we already expecting that within several years, the population gonna be dropped down really drastically.
Mm.
And then Korean government start to care about this problem really seriously, that how we can sustain our economy, our markets, and even first government take care of the taxation. So how we can continue our welfare, even how we can expand our welfare with the situation that the number of people gonna pay the taxes going down.
Mm.
That's one of the big issues we are dealing.
Mm.
And personally, I don't think that's a really big problem.
Mm.
Since anyway, the life expectancy is very long in here. Like my grandmother, grandfather is 97, 94. They are still working at the field as a farmer, really actively. And not only my grandparents, and many people are still really active. They can be active. And then I think also with the development of the technology, all these machines can replace some labor works.
Mm.
Then I think the population decrease is not a really big problem.
Okay.
That's what I see. But still, yes, we have to deal with some of these issues.
Mm.
But at the moment, it's Korean government see that's one of the biggest issue.
Okay.
And then second, I have to also mention about the air pollution problem in Korea.
Okay.
So since last 5 years, it has been really serious.
Mm.
This year, this spring was one of those serious air pollution happened and over Korea. So even there, we call it as a disaster, like kind of natural disaster. And government started to take some measures to handle these problems. They stopped some fire power plant. They banned to work it, and also they banned for some truck drivers to working, etc. And also construction site has to stop working while we have this extreme like air pollution day.
Mm.
That is getting one of the most serious problems in the city.
Why is air pollution so bad? I mean, every day, like, I know that everyone looks at the Namsan Tower to see how air pollution is and then they bring out masks. But why is air pollution so bad in Seoul?
From the research which Korean government did, I don't know Chinese government are gonna agree with this or not, but they say that major like reason is the air pollution matters from China. Because in Chinese East Coast, there are many factories, as we all know. And then in the spring season, we have the wind from the west to east.
Mm.
That's a thing we have it seasonally. So then in every spring, we have this kind of like
very bad
air pollution. days we can have. And plus, yes, from 20 years ago, I don't know the exact date, but the Korean government recognized that maybe we have the problem with electricity, because everyday life in Korea now super rely on electricity. Everybody use phone and computer and everything. So if we don't have electricity, our life is done. So Korea government built, constructed several like power plant.
Okay.
And then, it also accelerated the air pollution problem, I believe. So combining all this problem and maybe also the changes of the weathers and also with the air pressures is getting really serious. We don't know yet. So now Korean government like spend a lot of money. They invest a lot of money to figure out what is the major like issue and what can be done for it. But we have to see what's going to happen like for the next times. Yeah.
Okay. So I also wanted to know a little bit about what you're doing. So I know that you've been working with the Seoul government a lot also, and you've been working with projects around the world. But what sort of projects are you doing to help Seoul sort of regenerate itself?
Yes. As a urbanist, I'm working on different projects. One of the main projects we are doing is to make an overall plan for making changes for a neighborhood.
Okay.
So first we analysis on the conditions of the existing neighborhood, and then we listen many of the opinion from the people, neighborhood people. So sometimes we make some workshops to understand what is the real problem, and we bring some other experts to discuss on these issues. And then second, we make the plan. As a urban planner, we make drawings, and also we make some calculations to make changes. And then third part we are really focusing on is we try to educate people. Because although government do something to make the changes on the neighborhood, but if people's mindset has not changed, then it doesn't mean that much. But if each people's mindset is changing, has been changed, then no matter is the situation, it can have bigger like effect. So we try to make people understand what we are doing and what is a problem, what can be better. And we try to imagine a little bit better future with the neighborhood. And then we try to make them understand the situations and changes. And then we make them have a better like knowledge and also vision for the future. That's what we are doing majorly.
That sounds awesome, because I think like as a resident of any city, you should be invested in where you're living and think about how you want to live, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, so this is my last question.
Okay.
But if someone wants to know more about Seoul or its urbanization or something, do you have like any books that we should read or any videos that we should watch? Or can you think of something?
That's the one thing I feel really shame that there are not that much like materials can be used to understand Korea, either Seoul in English or other languages. So maybe I cannot pick one or two like reference books for it, but still I wish you can at least see many Korean movies and also Korean TV dramas. I think those are the best kind of like medias at the moment to understand Korea. Especially, I try to not to watch that much Korean TV programs, but if you see it, then you can see also how it looks like, and plus how people really feel about their daily life. Whenever I watch those TV programs, all different topics they are dealing, but based on the baseline, there are Korean people's basic concept on their life, their families, and their jobs, and to society, and to the government, all different things you can understand, I think. But I wish I can also write some nice books to make people can have a glimpse of Seoul.
I will wait for your book to come out.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for speaking with me.
Thank you.
With that, we come to the end of this episode of States of Anarchy. I agree with Yang Yang. TV dramas and film are a great way to learn more about South Korea. And since I'm such a huge fan, I've added a list of some movies and films to get you started. and also some other resources on Seoul's urbanization. If you have any comments or questions, then do reach out to me at @statesofanarchy on Instagram or @HamsiniH on Twitter. You can listen to States of Anarchy not only on the IVM podcast app, but also on iTunes and Spotify or Castbox or wherever you get your podcasts. If you haven't subscribed already, just click on the button and before you know it, we'll be back next week.
Filter coffee is a fascinating beverage. You need to pick the right beans, blend them in the right proportion, roast them to perfection, and slow brew at the right temperature to get the perfect cup. Which is exactly like great conversations as well. You need to track down the most interesting minds, get them into their zone, and settle down for an unhurried, unscripted chat. And coffee for me is always, always, always best enjoyed with friends. I'm Karthik Nagarajan, and do share my table as I meet some of the most interesting people I know and sit them down for a strong cup of coffee and an even stronger conversation. Join me every Wednesday for a freshly brewed episode. This is not Frappe. This is the Filter Coffee Podcast.
Hey, this is Shudaditya.
And I'm Amit Doshi.
And we host Shunya One.
It's a really fun podcast where we talk to some of the best entrepreneurs in the country.
Yes, talking about everything from their startup challenges to what they're building and all the future of technology right here.
So catch us on the IVM Podcast website, app, or wherever you listen to your podcast from.